Good morning. Today is Monday, April 10, 2017, and I call the public county judicial court to order. Today we have Bert Mormon from Hope Street Medical Center of Invocation, so please stand and remain standing in the pledge.
Let's bow together in prayer. This week of God is a reminder to us in many ways of the difference between the love of power and the power of love. As we gather this day, we ask your blessing of discernment upon those who are in public service, those who are in all realms of decision-making, may they be guided by your wisdom and spirit for what you intended in your creation when you said you made this, and it's the good stuff. Awaken us to the blessing of your presence to be guiding this week, that all that we are, say, and do would reflect your love for all creation, for it is in your holy name that we pray. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Under the Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
First thing on the agenda is the recognition of minutes from the March 27th, 2017, to the Clark County Commissioners Court meetings. Any changes to that? If no, so recognize. And the two vouchers to consider and act upon the approval of the payment of vouchers processed by the County Auditor's Office for the period of March 22nd, 2017, to April 5th, 2017. Check numbers 174169 through 174377 and wire transfers 879 through 883 in the amount of $2,287,484.19.
Make a motion that we approve the vouchers as presented.
Second. Have a motion and a second. All in favor? Show your hand. Three insurance report. Okay. Looks the same to me. But you still come up.
Well, I'm mixed up as well.
There is nothing unusual on this insurance funding report. However, I do want to make you aware that on the next insurance funding report coming up, you will see a transfer of $250,000 from Texas Class into the A and B account, and that's just simply to keep the balance a little higher in that operational account for A and B, so we don't have to watch it fly as well closely. You see that next time around.
All right, so recognize number four, Human Resources Report, to hear a report on the Department of Treasury account 4564 information document request, and any action necessary.
You should have a summary and more packets today. We have still not, as of yet, received the final documents from the IRS. However, on Friday, we did receive a phone call, but those final documents were placed in the mail, so they should be coming within the next few days, and we'll review them and then forward them to the county attorney for review, and you should see something next commissioner's court.
Number five, Potter Randall Child Welfare Board to recognize April as Child Abuse Awareness Month. Is Miss Ingram in the audience?
She's not.
Is there anybody want to say you want to get up for her?
Well, I guess I'm on the board, and I just want to express our thanks for all that y'all do for us. It really means a lot for that kind of support, for just for the community in general.
Sure. We do this every year. And every April is that we have the lights on the Santa Fe building lit up today too. I just want to read one little part of it here. There were 2,127 alleged victims of child abuse in 2016, and out of those, 591 were confirmed victims. That is way large. So we as a community must do something about that.
I move that we approve the resolution indicating that April is Child Abuse Awareness Month.
Second. Motion and a second. In favor, raise your hand. Okay, number six, reports to claims. To hear an update on reports to claims alliance and extension of I-27 by Captain Nichols, Vice President of Membership and Market Intelligence, to take any action necessary. Good morning, Dr.
Good morning, Erin. Thank you for having me. Appreciate the chance to come and give you an update. I'm going to start just for some of the new people in here who may not know a whole lot about horse claims. Y'all have your monitors on, I guess?
Yes.
Okay. All right. We'll start then. Horse to claims started in the city of Lubbock. It was when Randy Dogenbauer, who was since after that a congressman, but he was on the county commission. He was on the city council, and he and Mayor Wendy Sitton. After NAFTA was implemented in 1994, we knew that there was going to be a need for more north-south highways to move trade back and forth between Canada, the U.S., and Mexico. So that it started in City of Lubbock. They funded it for several years until we were able to stand alone on our own. So the original designation, which was done in 1998, and you can see the map here, it's just the four states. It's just under 1,400 miles in length. And the goal was to exist, the goal was to upgrade the existing highways to four lane divided. And then there were 15 relief routes planned in 113 miles. And then right now about half of it in these four states is complete. It's either four lane or four lane divided. So the Lubbock Council, the Chamber of Commerce in Lubbock, and some other interested people went around and put together a horse to claims founding members, because we knew we were going to have something to fund us so that we could someday stand alone. So this is the founding members that we started out with, and as you can see, Carter County was a founding member of horse to claims back in the mid-90s and ongoing. So horse to claims then, to know that we had to get all the way up into the Canada, Horse to Plains connected and partnered with three other partnerships, the Heartland Expressway, Theodore Roosevelt Expressway, and then later the Eastern Alberta Trade Corridor. So in Lyman, Colorado, it turns into the Heartland Expressway. That goes north up into Rapid City, South Dakota. And then in Rapid City, South Dakota, it turns into Theodore Roosevelt, which goes all the way up into Montana and Alberta, Canada. And then, of course, the Eastern Alberta corridor is in the province of Alberta. So those are our partners right now, so that we can get all the way from Canada to Mexico on the Horse to Plains Alliance. So today, we have over 275 members of the coalition. They consist of cities, counties, economic development agencies, chambers of commerce, businesses, colleges, and universities. They all pay their fair share for the Horse to Plains memberships. We have a volunteer board throughout the corridor. They represent a lot of leadership. They range from county judges, city council, county commissioners, mayors, city managers, and they go from Del Rio all the way up into Alberta, Canada. We even have one from Alberta who's on our board. We have about 18. And so they give us a lot of leadership for Horse to Plains as a board positions. If you look at the map here, you can see that Horse to Plains is North America's agricultural heartland, producing over $111 billion annually of agricultural goods. That's a little over 28% of the U.S. total. And then, of course, Canada and Mexico are one in three top export markets for U.S. products. So you can compare the maps there. That dark green is agriculture, so you can see. And this is just, I'm going to go into why this is so important. It justifies the need to upgrade the existing highway system to four lane or better to be able to export these goods. Horse to Plains is also North America's energy corridor. Within the nine states that we go through now, it contains five of the top six of the six top producing gas producing states, six of the top 10 oil producing states, and nine of the top 12 states with big power potential. So oil and gas, I mean, it puts tremendous pressure on the existing infrastructure. You can see here that just to develop one oil well would take a little over 2,600 truck movements. So that's a lot of wear and tear on the rural heartland of America. So that's another reason that we you know, stress more funding for rural America so that it will go into some more metropolitan areas. First appliance, there's eight of the top 10 installed wind energy states. You can see there the map again where first appliance goes, and then the yellow is the potential wind energy. So that's putting tremendous pressure as well. If they were going to build a 4,000 megawatt wind farm, it would take 2,667 towers, and that would require over 40,000 trucks and over 53,000 pilot cars just to put it in the wind farm. So you can see that's a lot of wear and tear on the infrastructure. So one day I was coming back from Denver, Colorado, and in Springfield, I ran into, but came up upon a truck that was carrying some wind blades. And I don't know how many of you have been to Boise City, Oklahoma, but you know there for a while you had to go around the roundabout to continue on 287. So I jumped ahead because I just wanted to see. I've never seen how one of these trucks with the wind blades was able to get around that roundabout in that courthouse. So I got ahead of it and took pictures, and you know, they had to get a permit, they had to stop traffic in Boise City, and you could just see how this was a major deal. And this was when the wind farms were just getting started. I mean, this is when it was really starting to pick up, so you can see how it just really, really takes a lot of it out of that small town, and you know, disrupts traffic and you know, school children and everything else. And so the good news about that is one of our accomplishments is we were able to get a relief route in Boise City. So now as you go into Boise City, you can just continue on a relief route. The trucks don't have to go around that roundabout at all now, so it makes it a lot more efficient. And we do have more and more and more wind blades and wind components coming down the first plains highway. Other successes that we've had over the last decade, First Plains Alliance members have raised over $1 billion in federal funding for road improvements. Some of these include New Mexico. Back on that map, you saw that spur that goes from Dumas to Dalhart to Clayton to Raton. And it didn't dead end there, that's where it connected with I-27. But New Mexico wanted to be a forest appliance, so they fought really hard back in the early days to have that spur that went to I-25. And so in 2005, they broke ground on their almost 90 miles of highway on 87. By 2007, the first segment was complete four lane. And then in 2012, they had already completed four lane to New Mexico. So actually, New Mexico, I call them my poster child. They're the first forest appliance state to completely be four lane. So that was with the help of Governor Richardson and his GRIP program, and then just the help of forest appliance and the lobbying that we have done for transportation funding. So another accomplishment was the Dumas overpass over that railroad there on 87. Had a groundbreaking in 2014 in Big Spring for the relief route there. There's 26 stoplights that go through, of course, Amarillo. I don't know how many of y'all have in your downtown on 287, but there are 26 stoplights. And so it was just crucial, TxDOT thought that we do a relief route around Big Spring. And so this was the groundbreaking pictures in 2014. You can see Commissioner Bill Crooker there. He's since passed on, but they actually named it the W.B. Crooker Highway because he was so adamant and was on our board of directors for many, many years to get this relief route built. They just broke ground, or they actually just left the second half of that relief route just a few months ago, so they're working on that now. So there will be soon a relief route going all the way around Big Spring that will definitely help the efficiency of trade. Another thing Forest Appliance does that helps contribute to our success is we go to Washington, D.C. at least twice a year. We meet with every congressman, every senator that's in the Forest Appliance states that are in the Forest Appliance Alliance. And so there will be several of us go. Our members go with us, staff and our board of directors go. We split up, we all go into these offices over a two-day period. You know, one of the things that always fascinates me is when we get into these offices and we'll go into, say, to Senator Cornyn's office, and there'll be Michael Reeves, the president, and myself, and then there may be someone from North Dakota, someone from Montana, someone from South Dakota in there. And so then they can just see how the alliance works together, all for the same cause, to improve the rural infrastructure throughout the alliance. And so we also have a consultant in Washington, D.C., Jack Shenador, who he is very well known in Washington and has helped. In fact, he's helped us get the money for that relief route in Boise City. Really, really was an asset to that. He just made one call and was able to get that money. So he's been really good to help get the funding for Forest Appliance as well. So we're actually planning a trip April 24th to the 28th to go back to DC again. And then we're going to be talking about I-27, which I'll mention here in just a minute, in Texas anyway. So our biggest initiative right now is expanding Interstate 27. We know that's going to be a significant tool for our communities to use. The expansion of I-27 can bring more industry, more businesses into the Forest Plains region. The projected estimated cost that TxDOT did, they just did an initial study, was about $7 billion to expand I-27 throughout the whole state of Texas. Expansion just from Lubbock to Laredo is projected at $5 billion. So actually what we're really looking at right now is from Lubbock to Laredo. We thought we would do that first. We're seeking a federal designation for that. But the reason we're doing that is because, you know, there has to be a logical terminus where an interstate has to either end at a population of 100,000 or more, has to connect to another interstate, or it has to connect to an international border. So the reason we're going south is because that way we won't have to work with other states or anything, because Dumas doesn't have that population and all of that. If we went north first, then we'd have to go all the way to I-70. That would mean working with Oklahoma and working with Colorado as well. So what we're really pushing for right now is Lubbock South. And then once we get that developed, we think that they'll definitely see the need to go Amarillo North, and then the other states can follow suit there. So, you know, that sounds like a lot of money, $5 billion, just to go from Lubbock to Laredo. But if you look here, there was a project recently on I-35 that was a 28-mile section that cost $4.8 billion. So, you know, we're a lot more cost-effective in Texas, and if our right-of-way is cheaper, we can get a lot of more bang for our buck. And so we just know that, you know, with the congestion on I-35, they can continue to do these projects and for billions and billions of dollars. But until they really look at other interstates or other good roadways for trade and have alternate roadways, they're, you know, as soon as they build it on I-35, they're just going to completely be congested again. That's kind of, you know, with the population growing so much in Texas. So the Texas Freight Mobility Plan has some really good quotes in it that I wanted to bring out. The one that stands out most to me is by 2040, over 73% of Texas population and 82% of the state's employment is projected to be located within 5 miles of an interstate. So, you know, I-35, there's not a north-south interstate west of I-35. So to me, that could be I-27 right there, help relieve that congestion and bring some of these businesses and these employments, industries that employ people and all that to the interstate on I-27. So you can see here that they actually even mentioned Forest Plains Roadway US 277, 287 as vital non-interstate primary freight networks corridors. So we're actually going to be able to get some more funding as a result of that. Loop 335 here in Amarillo, once we can get that federal designation for I-27, that will open up more funds to build out Loop 335. So U.S.-Mexico trade supports the extension of Interstate 27. I mean, with trucks moving 82% of U.S.-Mexico trade, you know, we need better, safer highways to do that. I-35 in Austin is the number one ranked corridor for truck congestion in the state. You know, if we get I-27 built from Lubbock to Laredo, it's going to have a significant impact on all of us, because if we can turn those trucks in Laredo before they get on I-35, if they're going north or they're going northwest, and they come up the Forest Plains Highway, then we know that that's going to bring economic development to our communities. So the timing right now is right for I-27. With TxDOT having more funding available than in recent years with Prop 1 and with Prop 7, the Trump administration has proposed the $1 trillion infrastructure package. The TxDOT and latest federal highway bill places new emphasis on the freight movement. And then overlap with Interstate 14, I don't know if you've been keeping up with that, but that's another interstate that was just recently designated that will go across in San Angelo. So, you know, we have the possibility of connecting with I-40 in Texas, and then I-20, I-14, and I-10, and then all the way to the international ports in Del Rio, Eagle Pass, and Laredo. So, Representative Dustin Burroughs, out of Lubbock, carried that bill 869. Last I heard, it was on the consent calendar, and I know Senator Charles Perry from Lubbock is going to take it from there. We really do expect good results in the state to be able to get the feasibility study so that we can see if we can get this federally designated. Of course, when we go to Washington, we're going to be pushing it really hard too in a couple of weeks. You know, if we can get them to get on board and get our federal legislators on board, and get, you know, we could even have it done without the feasibility study. A lot's changed. They did that feasibility study like in 1997, and at that time they just didn't feel like the need for Fort Stevens to be an interstate. They thought four lane would be, you know, to be efficient enough. But with the population growing in I-35 and I-25 in Colorado, just continually getting more populated, that they know now, TxDOT knows that there's a need for another north-south route. So we know it's going to take a lot of time to do this. Even if we're federally designated, it could take decades to get it built out. This is just some history on I-27. The four laning was complete in 1960, designated as an interstate in 68 from the federal highway bill. And this is just that 100 miles from Amarillo to Lubbock. And the construction ran from 1975 to 92. The total cost for I-27 at that time was $453 million, which we know the costs have gone up significantly since then. But, you know, we do see some opportunities there that we can take and extend. You know, they always said the standing joke was, well, if you go from Amarillo to Lubbock, where do you go from there? But you turn around and you go back to Amarillo. Of course, in Lubbock, we say you go to Amarillo and back to Lubbock, but anyway, it's going to really open up some possibilities. So another thing I just wanted to talk to you about was we're going to have our Energy and Agriculture Summit on June the 13th and 14th in Denver, Colorado. Of course, all of you are invited to attend that. You know, because of the energy and the ag movement that we have on the Plains Highway, we figured we need to go ahead and include them in and have an annual conference every year with just them every year and our members so that we can see what we can do for them, how we can work together to help upgrade the system. And then our 20th annual conference and reunion is in Lubbock, September 12th and 14th. We move this conference around every year. We have it in all 9 states of the Forested Plains Alliance, and even including the province of Alberta, we've had some there. So of course, all of you invited there. We're going to have some people who have been very, very important with Forested Plains. We're hoping to have Mayor Sitton back, Randy Nottebauer back. And now that he's not congressman anymore, we're hoping he can be a part of that celebration. So all of you invited to that. So I'll stop here. I did take pictures of here. Things look like we just clown around a lot with the Forested Plains Alliance, but this is the board and the staff. This is different conferences that we've had throughout the year. You know, the first one where our chairman, John Birch from Plainview, is talking to a radio personality there, Trent Lewis. The second one, we actually had a conference in Williston, North Dakota, and they just built this huge rec center and has the indoor water surfing. So that's the mayor pro tem from Clayton, New Mexico. I don't think he knows I showed that every time. And of course, this is Michael Reeves and Doug Cameron from the province of Alberta. That was in Medicine Hat at a conference. The next picture is all of us in Washington, D.C. in front of the White House. We actually had a meeting in front of the executive building one time. The next picture is a few of us at the oil sands in Alberta, Canada. And then the next one is in Acuna, Mexico, where we had a conference. So we have a lot of fun. You know, I tell people a lot that since I'm the Vice President of Membership and Marketing, I travel a lot up and down the Forested Plains Corridor. There's not very many people that can start out in Acuna, Mexico and drive to Saskatchewan. And if I had a flat, I could pick up the phone and call somebody who can change it for me because I know someone in every community along Forested Plains. So we're a really close-knit alliance and we work together at these conferences. What's so important about them is you're going to meet other county judges, other city managers, county commissioners, councilmen, you know, they all come together, we compare, we share stories, you know, so it's a really good networking event for you to come. And so I'll close now, which is that, you know, we're a founding member of Forested Plains, and we would really, really like to have you back as a member. And like I say, it's all fair share, it's 10 cents per capita for the population of the counties. And so if you have any questions. Thank you again for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Do
you
have any
questions? Just 10 cents per person.
10 cents per capita. I believe y'all's dues would be 12,000 in the world.
Carrie, how long ago was it when we did this? When did we stop?
It's probably been
do you know, without being specific, because I think I know, but why did we stop? Was what?
Was complete.
Was complete.
Well, I think if we can add this as a placeholder for budget, you know, makes the most sense to kind of vet that out. I think we tried a couple of years ago as well, something during budget, we can just add it, that's that.
Well, and you know, if I could say this, you know, in Lubbock, all of that was complete too, I-27 was complete, but until you get all of it done, you're not actually gonna get all the benefits. And, you know, by coming together and having a loud voice at Washington and at the state capitol and all of that, we can all work together. And so, you know, we have, you know, senators or whatever, is Potter County a member of this thing? You know, they wanna know that their constituents, they wanna know that everyone is on board for what we're doing, because it is a worthy cause. It is gonna help all of our communities. You know, I'm from Florida, born and raised in Florida, I live in Lubbock now. And you know, that poor little town is suffering, and you know, I just wish it was closer to I-27, because I feel like the communities that are on I-27, you know, if this thing is developed completely through, it's just gonna be a win-win. So I hope you will consider it. Thank you.
I do have just one quick follow-up question, if I can. As you look at the development plan, the vision around that, often I think highways are given a different kind of attention. They could be used in an effective way, but they can also potentially be used to separate communities. Sometimes that happens as new highways go into a city. How does Ports to Plains work with the communities, and or is there any tension on what is potentially proposed for those that live around that area? You know, not everyone welcomes a highway in that community, and I've often seen it where a lot of tension is on different socioeconomic levels.
Right. So you're talking about relief routes or like the interstate?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, how do you vet that?
You know, we don't determine where the relief routes go or where the interstate's gonna go. That's strictly the federal and TxDOT, you know, in the state. They decide where all that's gonna go. And so I know that there are some towns who have had a little bit of heartburn about, you know, relief route going in. Boy City did for a while. They were like, look, if y'all bypass our town, we're just gonna be killed. But you know, Love's moved out a little bit closer to the relief route. They put a big sign. In fact, about 6 months after they got that relief route, I was in the little Love store or whatever, and he said, you know, at first our revenue kind of dropped a little bit, but then it started building back up because the trucks could see it. And it was so easy just to get off right there and then get back on the relief route and go on. And so now the tax base has gone up considerably since then. In fact, Love's was doing so well that the CEO flew out there because he thought there was a booking mistake, he said, because they had increased so much. And so one thing that we try to do is we just try to go, especially to these smaller towns, and say, you know, we're not gonna tell you when you're gonna get a relief route. That's up to the community to decide and TxDOT to decide. But what we wanna do is work with you, because what we are doing is increasing traffic, it is increasing trade, it is going to increase population, and so we just want you to be ready. So if you can annex, you know, some of the acreage in, or you know, outskirts of town or whatever, annex that in, so that you know, when you do get your relief route, you can put your truck stop, you can put your hotels, and you can get that tax base off of it, you know, or the county can do that as well. So you know, that's just the main thing we do, is just let them know that it's a potential that could happen. And so, you know, a lot of them still just say, no, we don't want it, we don't want it. But, you know, a lot of these smaller towns, we're looking at maybe 20 years away still. You know, I know Stratford, you know, they're not real crazy about getting really far out. But, you know, we keep telling them, you know, that's probably going to be 20 years away. Although, I really think they could kind of use it now. With 57 going right through there, and with the railroad separation, they at least need that. I've heard that they, you know, lost some patience because there would be a train and they couldn't get over. So, you know, I think Stratford needs some work on it. But you know, Daniel Wright is still a board member from Stratford and still believes in Ports to Plains, and you know, we just hope that we can work with them to the best of our ability to make it work for them.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy. We will consider this a great time.
All right.
And when you start coming, we start in the middle of summer.
Soon. All right. Well, let me know if you have any questions.
Okay.
Because
it kind of is.
Yeah.
I will let you know if we do have any questions. We appreciate you coming.
All right, thank you so much.
All right, no
Number seven, quarterly budget comparison. We recognize the second quarter comparison report in FY 16 and FY 17. I don't have any questions. Do you have any questions?
I do. I've already talked to Carrie about this, but our public service funds look like they're getting wiped out pretty quickly with all the cremations. So I guess we'll have to address that subject.
Our hands are tied on that.
I don't think we have to do it.
We did 85 last year. 85.
How many this year? So
I think probably our answer has.
Pretty close to that, man.
Anything else on that? Okay, so recognize. Financial report. We recognize the comprehensive annual financial report for fiscal year ended September 30, 2016. Moving right along, number nine, fire rescue to consider and act upon allowing fire rescue to use the expense reimbursement funds to contain handle being next to the train wreck or uniforms in amount of $12,463.75 into the budget. And I understand we have an additional $5,200 added to that. That is correct. Okay.
Yes. Last year we responded to Panhandle when the Burlington Northern train has crashed. We don't bill mutual aid in the Panhandle. All of us go and help each other. But in this case, Panhandle said send us a bill, and they billed Burlington Northern for it through emergency management to get the stuff from Potter County, Greenham County. And we would like to take that money if we could and put it in our uniform account to buy turnouts with. We'll buy additional turnouts with it this year.
Would that mean your budget would be less next year?
It'll be the same. It'll be the same.
What?
We won't have to increase it by $20,000 for next year.
So I'm not sure I was following how the money got to us.
We took our time. That's for us to take our time from our trucks, right, and from our personnel. We were there 40 something hours with trucks and with people over there total while we were there. And we ran those numbers through, and they put rates on and sent them in.
And they is BNSF?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Just check it. These checks are for BNSF.
Okay. And we weren't expecting that.
We worked on it.
Okay.
We kind of didn't know if it was coming or not. You never know when you're doing that kind of billing. We don't ever do that much, so it was kind of an unusual thing for us. They're Burlington Northern's in Potter County. They're taxpayers in Potter County. Mm-hmm. We're not going to send them anything.
Sure.
But the city of Panhandle, they do, so.
Mm-hmm. This was a little bit different because there was a huge lock available to BNSF for what happened. So they will reimburse them involved.
And all of the fire departments involved have equipment loss. We had a lot of hose, we had a lot of turnout gear that was destroyed. And that's why we're coming here asking to put in our uniform account. Is all joking aside, this is about 6.5 to 7 cents a year. So if we don't use this money to replace that year, then next year we'll be looking at an increase. And every year prices are going up anywhere from 3 to 7% for turnout gear. So we're always looking at increases, and we're just trying to stay ahead of the curve, because I have about 30 sets of 2005 gear that has to be thrown away. So we're getting to the point that we'll be in a bind if we don't take action. And we think this is the best route to go with these funds, is to try to get ahead of the curve. And we've also put in for a grant for assistance with turnout gear. So we're going to try to keep our budget line the same.
move that we accept the reimbursement funds from ENF, ENSF, and allow that money to be put into the uniforms.
Okay. You have a question? No, I was just going to confirm when Carrie gets the uniform account, but that was in the motions. Okay.
I have a motion in the second. All in favor of the idea? 5-0.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Number 10, tax notes. To consider and act upon an order authorizing the issuance of Powell County, Texas tax note series 2017, and resolving other matters.
Hello, Judge, Commissioners. A couple items you packed up, but well, hard copies in the event. It's the same.
They're the same, okay.
You just passed it down. I hope everybody has. I know everybody has exactly what we're looking for.
Mark, every time I see you, it's more debt.
And this one is actually, I think, an extremely good result. But yes, it is more debt.
Not reflecting on you at all.
As we've been working through the budget and the plans for the radio equipment, emergency radio equipment, we've been trying to work, Gary and I have been working a plan that's going to cause the least impact on your budget going forward. We developed this plan, and I think we've ended up with extremely good results today. We went out and bid $5,625,000 tax note. We did a private placement bid because of the short-term tenure of the loan, being 7 years. This route allowed us to avoid bond rating costs, underwriting costs, and so forth. And all we needed to do is find a purchaser that would buy it all for their own account. We went to Texas Independent Bank, J.P. Morgan, BB&T, BBVA, all big, large, regional, national banks. We also sent it to Happy State Bank and Amarillo National Bank, making sure that they were at least aware. We did not get bids from them. We ran all our numbers at 2.25% to 2.5%, and you can see on the far right-hand column, the best bid came in at 1.91%. This is a fixed rate bid, meaning it won't change. It's a 7-year loan, and it'll be held by Texas Independent Bank in their account. They will bill us directly, which is another $500, $400 a year discount because we're not having to get a paying agent. Now, the tight numbers, and they may go over here, is the tax rate impact. Now, I'm sorry the numbers are so small, but this is what's going to be really important when it comes time to doing your budget. The upper left-hand box is your current tax rate, 66.4 cents, with 4.01 cents dedicated to debt. The right hand is the 6-7 year history of your taxable value with the average growth rate over that time, 2.7%. We grabbed 1% growth rate for 3 years, so less than half of that growth rate. This is just on taxable value. Ran it for 3 years and then zero growth thereafter. Very unlikely. I think you'll find when the appraisal district comes out this year, we'll probably be looking at 3%, 4%, 5% this year. Some of the numbers that we're hearing, so well below. You have your current debt. We lay in right in the middle, column 4, the $5,625,000. Get total debt. If you look at column 5, our current debt is $2,808,000. When you roll this new debt in next year, it goes up to $2,872,000 before dropping again. If you go to the far right, you're going to see a little bit different number than what your tax rate is. My calculation is 3.94 cents. Your all's tax rate is 4.01. The difference is going to be tax collections. I don't know, Carrie, you do 99%. This is probably at 100% collections, because typically you get 99.5, if not greater. So again, being conservative. Now look at the following year, next year. If we get 1% growth, which I think we're going to do dramatically better, 3.997 versus where you are right now, 4.01. If we do 99% collection rate, perhaps that would be 4.01 or 4.02. Now, what you've done so well, you'll see a number there, your projected or your fund balance for fiscal year that we just finished on your INS fund is $1.9 million. So that $1.9 million can be used to offset or can be used for debt service, which will help you offset any tax increases if the growth doesn't come in, or set it up that it can be used for next year's payment and keep the tax rate, depending on what the commissioners look for, at the 66.4, or it's going to allow you to manage it without impacting these new notes. Will not impact the debt service portion of your budget for next year. That's really what this whole little presentation is about. We locked in great interest rates. We've got a declining debt service 2 years from now, giving you all opportunities to make decisions in the future, and ended up with really good interest rates. We want to proceed now because we know what the Fed is saying they're going to do. They raised rates about a month ago. Said they've got two more rates increases likely for this year and three likely for next year. So the sooner you lock in, the better off I think we'll be. We, like I said, we know we're entering a rising interest rate market, and we know we got sub 2% interest rates. So great time, not the world record lowest, but still very, very low compared to historical trends. That's everything I have. We, if you all approve it, about a month from now, funds will be in the account, and then you'd have really 3 years to spend those funds. But with the radios coming in, they'll be out of your accounts probably in months, as opposed to the IRS rule of 3 years.
So I have two questions.
Yes, ma'am.
First for Carrie, the 1.9 in the fund balance projection, is your thought to still just leave that there kind of as a reserve? If the, I know the growth is very conservative in the model. I think there was some thoughts of using some of that to offset this, but I'm hearing that's not the case anymore.
You may recall we used a little bit of that fund balance last year just to work with our tax rate. And it'll just depend on where we are during our tax budget process. Mm-hmm. But it is an option if we choose to do that.
Okay. And last year was the first year we've done that.
It is.
So I would agree. I think it's nice cushion that is there should we need that. But that's not the thought currently. Would we take the tax note, just leave that as a reserve, and know that if we need to address that during budget, we've got that to help offset the rate.
Correct, because the schedule for next year has minimal impact as it is.
Okay, and then my second question, maybe more of a global question, because we have not landed on the details of the Motorola contract, are we a little out of sequence that we're approving the money before we know what's gonna happen with the contract? And I'm sensitive to interest rates and all that, so I understand the
risk. No, that's a great question. And one of the comments in discussions we had with Carrie was, do we need to buy radio equipment? Is it? And that's a yes or no question. Whether it's today or 4 months from now or 6 months from now, if we know we need to buy them, and we know it's just emergency radio equipment, this is not necessarily for us tied to specific Motorola, but if we know we need to buy them, these funds are there to buy them. So the answer that I got was, yes, we are going to be buying emergency radio equipment. And so if we know we have to do that, then it's not out of sequence.
So because we don't do tax notes often, are there any restrictions? Are there any caveats? I'm just thinking through what we need to know once we go to the market, if you will.
It's for radio, emergency radio equipment. It, let's say this all blows up.
No pun intended.
You cannot use this money for jail, for a county court annex, a fire truck. It can only be used for radio, emergency radio equipment.
Okay, and then is there a limitation on how long we have to use the dollars?
That was the 85% within 3 years.
So you would recommend that we still proceed forward? You're comfortable with that, Karen?
Yes, and I would like to let you know, as soon as the tax notes were approved in Commissioner's Court, I went ahead and called Mark to get the ball rolling on this, and the bids went out to the various bidders before we knew that there were so many concerns with the contract. We didn't want to pull those bids back, so we didn't choose at that point after several of us discussed to
I would,
That's good.
I move that we approve the issuance of Potter County tax notes, series 2017, to Texas Independent Bank for an interest rate of 1.91%. For the use or purchase of emergency radio equipment.
Second. Motion is second. All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, bow to zero.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. After Commissioner's Court, we got a whole flow of documents to be signed. I'll stick around.
I'll be here.
Nice talking about it.
Thank you.
Okay, number 11, resolution to open assistance program to consider an act upon authorizing Judge Tanner to execute application for state assistance received from the Office of Attorney General for the victim assistant coordinator crime liaison grant, which would fund the new position for victim coordinator.
And Judge, every time I hear crime, I see Randall now is for a new position.
I'll see you at other places.
You stopped me to say there's a new position.
I just let you know. Okay, you may or may not already know, the district attorney's office fills three crime victim advocate positions. Two stay in the office. The third one is also is at the Amarillo Police Department. And the Amarillo Police Department pays half of that salary. She is a Potter County employee, but they reimburse for half of the expenses. So over there, there's been a lot more work than one person can do. So in the past, we have tried to rely on interns to help out with that. The last two internships didn't work out very well for various reasons. And it's Lori Gunn's fault, Commissioner Maria. She's great at finding grants. And she contacted me about a grant where we can get $42,000, no matching funds required at all, for a 2-year period. And specifically for something like this. The police department was also notified about it by Lori, and they are using that grant to try to fund the high-risk domestic violence head staff person that we're going to have. So the police department was already applying for that grant for that. After talking to all of us, we decided that would happen. And then, so they're not in a position to file to seek a position for another crime victim advocate over there. But I am. So that's why I'm doing it. We would get the $42,000. The chief of police has acknowledged to me that he will put in a budget for the city to then take care of the benefits, which would be above $42,000. And then do like they're doing with the current position, reimbursing the county for those benefit, the cost of the benefits.
So this position would be a Potter County employee?
Correct.
Instead of them reimbursing half the salary, like the one position, they would reimburse half the benefits, or the benefits in its entirety?
Correct.
Okay.
Right, they'll reimburse the benefits for the, over the salary. So, man, there's no sense in making them pay half for something we're getting for free, basically.
So this is just a two-year deal?
It is a two-year.
What happens after 2 years?
We'll apply again. We've been applying for the domestic violence grants for, or not domestic violence grants, sorry, the crime victim advocate grants for, well, 12 years since I've been in office, and Rebecca and them were applying for it before then, so. If something happens and this grant goes away, we can attach that other person to one of the other grants. This will go into effect October 1st of this year, 2017. So it's pretty, it was too simple to really have to be a grant. I gotta tell you, this is the easiest one I've had to deal with. So that's the plan. They need somebody else over there. There is a lot of paperwork that has to get pushed through over there at the police department. And we've been using interns, and it's just not worked out well the last two times, and it's put us in a pinch. So, and that person will also be able to come over and help, as Susie would if we needed to come back over to our office too to help some too.
Randall, I have two questions if I may. One for you and then one for Carrie. So I'm with you about this position, but I keep thinking through, you know, the volume is so big, we can't handle, which is a scary statement, you know, for victim assistance. What are we doing as entities, Potter, Randall, City, you name it, to continue to look at preventative measures so that we don't get to this point? I mean, I understand you're reacting to the problem right now, and I think that's one part of the conversation, but the other part is what's happening upstream?
Upstream would be, you know, a preventative measure would be to try to do something to reduce crime. Domestic violence is a big issue in our county, and we're working very hard on the program that we hope will do that for that area of offense. The PAD-2, Panhandle Burglary Theft Unit, has been an effort to reduce auto theft, which typically Amarillo's in its population bracket, usually been number one each month in the state of Texas for vehicle thefts. And while I'm at it, I'll just add, take your keys out of the car and it will save 60% of the motor vehicle thefts. If you just take your keys out of the car. So, sorry, had to do that.
It's you wouldn't think so.
Easy fix, and we have publicized that now for 2 years, and haven't scratched it very much.
Well, as the domestic violence preventative measure, I know that's new and it's hard to really gauge, but any information that you have to educate us on, even anything you want to ship independently, I think would be good for us to know, because we often don't get those conversations. We get the problems downstream, and now we need staff to react. Because I think that's important for us to be having that conversation. So just for what it's worth, I wanted to share that.
I think that also, and probably not directly related to Randall or Scott or APD and the member, but I wonder why we always seemingly be in the top tier in per capita.
It's like that with the homeless population, the kids in the school, the
community. So many different categories in this bank.
If we can figure out the answer to that, let me rephrase that. People in the criminal justice community have been trying to figure this out for 30 plus years, probably longer than that. And the person that ever finally figures that out will be a multi-billionaire.
Well,
because it will affect every city in the
are very
country.
Real. And right. that is in Potter County. When I describe the county, I often describe us as two ends of the spectrum. We have the affluently wealthy that live in Potter County, and we have the citizens that are really just trying to make it. And I think it goes back to what I know Commissioner Vaughn, you and I and Kelly, we all work on education and breaking that generational poverty cycle. Because that is often a driver to get out of these, I mean, often, I don't think everybody just is born bad. You make bad decisions because of your life circumstances.
But I'm focusing on Potter County. I mean, in respect to the whole state, I don't think Potter County has similar goals, conditions that are relegated just to Potter County. There are other counties that have similar issues that we face. So just a question, why is Potter County at the top tier?
Well, now it's become, well, not just now, but a decade ago, it became popular to start counting things per 1,000 or 100,000, that sort of thing. And that's when really it started to shed a light on how big our problem really is, right, for the civil commitments that are for people that are looking at being able to be paroled out on sex crimes. We've got more people in civil commitment per 1,000 than anybody else in the state of Texas. And I can explain that. That's because we're on the very high end of having aggravated sexual assault to children. So I can explain why those numbers, where those numbers come from. Why somebody commits a crime, I mean, that's as varied as the day is long. I mean, I've seen very affluent people doing accounting business for businesses and being the only one handling all the funds, and here you go, $300,000 is missing. So why they decide to cross that line, there's just some that are going to, statistically, so.
Just one more follow-up question, Judge Gary. These grants and positions, I think for me, are getting complicated to follow year to year. It would be helpful during budget time, because you know, we just get the roll-up salary line item when we say approve, you know, deny, and we debate it. But I think sometimes what gets us is, especially now that we have more grants, if there is a way to kind of parse out the positions that are tied to a grant, so if we don't, let's just, worst case scenario, if we don't get it, back to your question, Judge Tanner, if we don't get it in year two, we at least are having that dialogue about, do we fund this position? Is it risky? What happens? You know, and those are hard conversations we have to have. And certainly once we have an employee, those are people in their lives. And so I want to make sure that we're being transparent about that process with them. Because that is, I've worked under a grant before, and when the money isn't there, it's not there, and you don't have a job anymore. But if there was a way during budget, especially for our positions that are tied to other grants, we probably need to start looking at them a little differently, whatever you think is easier to follow.
I'll say this, I think we've got a great number of people working there at the Panhandle Regional Planning Commission, or local COG, that have, I mean, Lori's just helped us tremendously, helped us count tremendously in the criminal justice system with the things she's been able to come up with and find. And we haven't had that kind of person in that position before. And it's working out really well. Anybody got any other questions?
She's good because she didn't take them herself. Okay, no, I need a motion.
I make a motion to approve authorizing Judge Tanner to execute an application for state assistance to be submitted to the Office of the Attorney General for the Victim Assistance Coordinator / Crime Liaison Grant, which will fund a new position for a victim coordinator and benefits to be paid by the City of Monroe.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All in favor, raise your hand.
Thank you very much, Court, and thank you for the lights on the east side of the court's building.
Thank you.
Sure. Number 12, certificate of completion, required hours to recognize certificate of completion from the old Blackwood Law Enforcement Management Institute of Texas for Georgia Estrada, successfully completed 40 hours course and having newly elected constable. So,
Judge, just a quick comment. I have seen our constables quite a bit over the last even couple years, but I'm pleasantly surprised at how active they all continue to be in the community. And so, just a side note, I think we're doing a great job.
I do too.
Number 13, County Commission on Continuing Education to recognize Commissioner Gia. Certificate of completion for 16 hours of continuing education for 2016.
Do that.
Sometimes, some people do sometimes. Okay, so ready now. 14, formal bid number 1143-17, painting and surface refinishing services. Consider next on following. A, allow the opening of a single bid. And B, to award the contract to single bid or contingent upon the review and approval of the facilities management department.
This is going to be done in two parts. First, I need approval for formal bid 1143-17, painting and surface refinishing. I have received one bid, and I just need authorization for you guys to look and open it.
Need a motion on that?
Yes.
So move authorize the formal bid to be opened for painting and surface refinishing services.
Second.
Have a motion second. All in favor, raise your hand. Five zero, go ahead.
Okay, I'll open it, and then we give you the price here. Mike, as she's opening that, what are they painting? What is this for? I mean, I know.
This is for work to be done at, for our department, Sheriff's Department, Road Bridge Department.
So just a global painting project?
Painting, woodworking, refinishing.
You only got one bid? Just one?
Here's, if I could explain, one of the criteria for this bid is the contractors that bidded have to be able to work in historic building to meet the requirements of the Texas Historic Commission. We have three buildings fall under that gap. So I kind of shed some of the people away from bidding.
We had another vendor, but he did not want to respond. Okay, we got Palmer Painting Company. We've got a signed bid. The painting prices for labor rates, painter, regular time, $38.80, overtime, $58.20, cost per hour, holidays, $77.60. General labor, $28.80, cost for overtime, $43.20, and cost per hour, holiday, $57.60. And then the minimum trip charge, we identified at three areas, location inside the city limits, it's at $38.80. Overtime, $58.20, holiday, $77.60, and then road and bridge, fire rescue outside the city limits, $38.80, the same, $58.20, overtime, holiday, $77.60, and law enforcement center, detention center was the same, $38.80, overtime, $58.20, holiday, $77.60. Any markup on materials is 5% for both material and equipment. Insurance and overhead included in the rates. Also, this particular contract, we asked if they would be willing to do two additional renewals, and they said yes. And if insurance or liability cost goes up, they would adjust in the years accordingly, or the prevailing wage. So what we're gonna do now, Mike and I will need to go look at this compared to previous years, and then come back for the second.
Okay.
For the approval of the award. Okay, Mike?
And I know you've used them many, many times, and you're very happy with them.
Yes.
And they have very good references, by the way, just before.
Do you need the opens? Take a look at your calls. On the weekends?
I just want the overtime.
No, it's overtime on the weekends and holidays.
I'm there right now.
Get it for you. Okay, so all we need on that one?
Yes, so then we'll come back to it.
Okay. Number 15, adoption of retired K-9. To consider next upon a request for the Pottawatomie County Sheriff related to proposed adoption of retiring drug interdiction K-9. Sheriff. You did let the dog out, huh?
Very self-explanatory.
Yeah.
Just wonder, we're talking about the dog, the target. Are you gonna end up with the dog? I'm sorry, are you gonna end up with?
Joshua.
What kind of dog is it? German Shepherd?
Malamute.
Malamute?
It's a brown dog.
It's a brown dog.
She came down with some heart problems.
You'll be getting a new one, or you'll be having a?
We'll wait a little bit. We're not having very good luck with our dogs.
Okay. Did I hear, I don't know if this was us, Potter County, I heard about one of the law enforcement agencies taking on an adopted dog. That was the one half that you're just waiting to see how it does.
Yeah, we knew it. That was, we're gonna adopt one.
Right.
Before this one. And it was older than what we thought.
Oh, okay.
So we got this one, which was considerably cheaper. And we had her check and did her vet everything, she was fine, but she developed some heart problems. Doesn't allow her to continue with her.
Are we number one on the dog issues? State?
Per capita.
Per capita.
I move that we request of Potter County Sheriff to lay the proposed adoption of a retiring dog in addition to K-9.
Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. All in favor, raise your hand. So adopted. Number 16, disposition of surplus fire equipment to consider an act upon a request from fire and rescue to donate out of service SCBA equipment, self-contained breathing apparatus to the Texas Forest Service Helping Hands Program pursuant to authority granted by the Texas Education Code number 88-106C. Hi.
Hi.
I don't even know if you're there already, I was like, thank you.
What we have is, this year, we replaced all air packs, 62 of them. The department had a total of 64 air packs in service. We're only keeping two air packs out of everything. And those two were bought outright by the county. The rest of the air packs that we have all been purchased through grant funds or have been donated to us by the Texas Forest Service. So what I'm asking to do is, since there's no real value to be gained in putting in an auction, I would like to turn them all over to the Helping Hands program that have been donated to other fire departments so they can use them to put them in service. And in that, I have provided a list of equipment. As I said, there are 62 that we're getting rid of, and I have 12 of them that we have not been able to get checked off the property list. And I would like to get permission to get those cleared from the property list. And we had air cylinders that, when we first bought these, air cylinders were over $1,000 each. So every one of them had to be tagged. And what we did is we made one property tag for multiple air cylinders, because under Department of Transportation law, each air cylinder has to be inventoried, maintained, log, it has to be inspected and tested. So all of them are accounted for. 24 of them have been turned in on the trade-in due to the fact that they were either expired or close to it. In this year, in October, November, we have several more coming up for destruction. And in 2018, I believe it's the October, there will be several more come up for destruction. And what I'm asking to do is just remove this property item from our inventory, as we already have all of these bottles inventory through our provider, and they will be pulled out of service and destroyed as they need to be. And once they're removed from service, they have to be destroyed and they have to be logged in inventory. So they are all accounted for. They're just scattered out in different places. And furthermore, now the purchase of the air cylinders is less than $1,000. So if anything that we do buy now, it doesn't have to go through the tagging process.
I make a motion that we approve fire and rescue to donate out of service self-contained breathing apparatus to the Texas Forest Service Helping Hands Program.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor, raise your hand. Zero.
Thank you very much.
You want to hide there? You want to go ahead and do number 18, the garbage bin?
Okay. This year has been quite a year. We had some considerable rainfall come in, it dries out, we start burning, and we get more rainfall. So we're kind of going back and forth. Yesterday, we had a critical fire weather day.
but at the same time, our drought index was in the lower 100s. So looking at it, talking about it, talking to some of the other area fire chiefs, we're looking at just going ahead and lifting the burn ban for a period of time. So the people that have accumulated some of their household trash, some of the legal things that they want to burn, they can get that cleaned up and done. And that way, if we continue to see a drying pattern, then we go back into a burn ban a lot easier, I think. So my recommendation is we lift it for now, but we try to keep a monitor on it.
Make a motion that we approve lifting of the burn ban for the recommendation of our March. You have concerns, Commissioner Church?
Days like yesterday scared me.
Yeah, it's
and a lot of people like to burn no matter what.
Well, that's the problem is, and I share those sentiments. If it was up to me, I would say that we never allow outdoor burning again because it leads to nothing but problems.
Well, one thing we do have is direct correlation with the county judge, and we can implement that.
And that's what we'll do is I'll try to maintain a watchful eye on it. And a lot of times our weather, our forecast, our drought index, and everything else plays a game of catch up, get ahead, catch up. So in doing that, what I'll try to do is monitor conditions as well as, you know, the weather forecast. And if we start seeing an increase in fire problems, then I'll call the judge and we'll get it taken care of. One of the other things to think about too is we waited, you know, another week before looking at lifting it, just because of the fact that while it's raining, everybody wants to run out and burn. But at the same time, while it's raining, it's nothing but mud. So we get all of our trucks stuck trying to deal with, you know, the illegal burns and everything else. So it's kind of, you know, it's always a double-edged sword. And I do have reservations about lifting it and completely agree with that. But at the same time, I think if we don't, we're going to wind up with, you know, having to respond to a lot more illegal burns.
All right, number 17, Motorola Communication System Project, to receive a status report regarding the Motorola Communication System Project and act on the appointment of the county project management team for this project and to take such other action as may be appropriate regarding the project. Mr. Fowler.
The status on the contract is we completed our markups of what we were given from Motorola, and we'll be contacting people and their attorney about those. One of the requirements will be our county appointed project manager, project management team, and that's one issue I want to hope to take care of today. We have volunteers to serve on that team. Dallas Dodds with the Sheriff's Department at Fitzpatrick with Fire and Rescue. Jason Patrick with IT. And Eric Dobbs with the County Attorney's Office. So I would propose formalizing the appointment of those persons to serve as the county's project management team for the Motorola.
Do you understand what that, other than the title, what is some of the scope of what that team will do?
They'll be involved in design, construction design, construction planning, logistics of staging equipment, preparing our facilities for Motorola's arrival. An example would be installation of the dispatch on some of this, when the law enforcement center is completed, all those things need to be coordinated between Motorola's project manager and our project management team. Motorola's staff recommended that we definitely have someone from IT participate in that. So it's coordination of logistics.
Would it be helpful to have someone from facilities on that? I just think about our buildings and things happen.
I would welcome anybody. How?
Would you do it, Mike?
Yes.
that we appoint names that were presented with the addition of Mike Kent as mayor. Emergency radio.
Okay, the motion is second.
We have always opportunity for Commissioner to sit in on that.
Judge, just in terms of a quick discussion point, again, I don't know if we're out of sequence, appointing a team before we can finalize the contract, the vendor, all of those pieces. I get what you're saying, that it'll be helpful to have a coordinated effort. It's just we've not landed on anything in local. So I'm fine either way. I just want to publicly make sure the court knows again.
I think this is also working with the nuts and bolts of it.
Yeah, this team can help us get to that point.
Okay.
I prefer to get that vision to the city's points.
Okay.
Okay, I have a motion to second to appoint that team. All in favor, raise your hand. Chad, would you read those names again, please?
I'll try. Dallas Dots. Patton Patrick. Jason Patrick. Eric Dots.
Okay, anything else on the Motorola? Or no?
Go ahead, any questions?
I could get a copy of the contract. I think I requested that last court. I think I have it.
We don't have a contract yet. We have a form that Motorola submitted and our market's work. We would like all the commissioners to have.
That'd be good.
That, it would need to be with the, it is attorney work product. It contains attorney work product, which is privileged. It would be needed to limit that as much to be disseminated or disclosed to anybody else, but we would like you all to prepare that.
Yeah, even if you'd rather have a paper form of it and not electronically communicate.
I have paper copies of mine.
If you want to just drop it in our box, or you just pick, you can pick mine up. I'm happy to do whatever you need.
Whatever's not there.
I do have one small update. I talked to Ty about this on Thursday. On the pricing that we're getting for Potter County, the HGAC pricing, HGAC is reaching out to Sean, our Motorola rep, because the summary was strictly a summary. We need it itemized. So we're there.
Okay. And in comparison to what Sidney, they indicated they would give us a copy of their contract in open court. So, okay.
We don't care about that yet.
Keep working. Okay, number 19, employment items to consider next on the following employment items. The corrections and transfer of health Martinez as receptions and corrections to the county attorney's office effective March 25th, 2017. And in records management regarding the Wally Strong and the Michael Film clerk as a replacement for Dusty Pitt effective April 10th, 2017.
Make a motion that we approve the employment items as presented.
Have a motion in a second. All in favor, raise your hand. 5-0. Thank you.
On that form, Ted, would you prefer us to come by your office and physically pick that up rather than put it in the box?
That would be fun. Our candidate that is ready for the book. Whoever wants to drop out of the pool.
Potter County Fathers, not the only thing that's up there. Jail report, we have 507 individuals in our jail. 83 of those were female, none of them are in Childress. Felony populations, 83%, and misdemeanor populations, 12%. Regular county insurance items, no, we do not. Okay, executive session, agenda items, anything to discuss next time?
Well, you need to go back to item number 14 to continue the award.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah, we evaluated.
I'll work fast.
Huh?
I'll work fast.
Well, it's, we have a review of the minutes.
Okay.
Mike had myself and our senior buyer, Matt Crandall, looked over. The increase is about $2.80 on the regular cost per hour from the previous 3 years, which is, we did our math calculations, less than 2% on the regular. So we're making recommendations to award formal bid 1087-14 to Palmer Payne.
It was formal bid 1143, right?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I was talking about last year's. It's 1143-16. Sorry about that.
Okay. I make a motion that we approve bid 1143-17 to Palmer's Paint.
Second.
Okay, have a motion in second. All in favor, raise your hand. 5-0, thank you very much, Vicki. Just a quick reminder that our next meeting will be on the Santa Fe Building, 11-4. It's Potter County Government Day. So we're expecting around 80-ish students. I'm looking at, hey, I'm sure I have my number wrong, but around 80 students. All the schools are participating, so we're very excited about that. And if you have not paid your $10 and you plan on joining, please do so. We're down to the final numbers. And those that are on the committee, we're meeting in the conference room right outside of court, just to finish last minute items.
Okay, I have just one. I was going to discuss this thing when we looked at the vouchers, and no one raised any questions. So I have a question on vouchers. I'm not going to go back and change the vote or anything. I just, there's a expenditure in a certain court for athletic shoes for Baylor. And I think that Carrie and I have talked about this. We're going to establish some sort of committee to come up with certain things that you cannot buy with your budget, even though we give you a budget to spend. I really think that athletic shoes are probably not part of the uniform. And so we're going to come up with a committee that's going to say what is you can buy and what you cannot buy.
Is there any causation as for why that?
It's not, I just want to make sure it's not a special accommodation for an employee.
It's not.
Okay.
It's, I'll show you.
Okay.
Okay, that's just, so anything else? Bob? Oh, yes, ma'am.
Do you have to five?
The five?
Five. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much. I'm sorry, Darla Ingram couldn't be here.
Right.
And so I got as quick as I could, and it wasn't in time. But I just wanted to say thank you. I think you all recognize April as Child Abuse Awareness Month. So thank you. I'm Patty Huff. I'm sorry. I'm the volunteer coordinator for the Rainbow Room, which is an emergency resource room at the local Child Services Office. And so, yeah, we just wanted to say thank you for recognizing that. I think anything to bring any more awareness to child abuse and neglect, we absolutely appreciate. So, and you guys support us financially every year, so thank you so much. It helps us meet the needs of the kids, cribs, car seats, toddler beds, all those things that, the kiddos need when they get removed from the home and things like that. So we just want to thank you guys so much for that continued support.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. You were late, but thanks. I'm glad you said that.
We put something on our website designating this as a job.
Absolutely.
So,
we've got the light on the Santa Fe for you.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Did you say something?
No.
Thank you. But anyway, thank you guys.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We're adjourned. Thank you very much.